so far, we've been focusing on assessment, its history, its evolution, and its components. But really, all along, we've also been talking about two other things: educational systems that have developed as a consequence or in relationship, and of course the life worlds of the learner and the teachers in this environment. So we have a timetable, we have periods, we have a textbook, we have a number of learners, 25, 35, maybe 50, one teacher, maybe a teacher support person. And during those periods, the learners engage with some chunk of the textbook, and as a consequence of these unfolding, they end up with some kind of assessment that evaluates how well they've imbibed what the teacher expected them, or the journey, the learning journey that the teacher took them through. And we've also said that this kind of teaching that we're all very familiar and learning, all of us very familiar, had the effect of sorting us in the school and outside of the school, and sometimes through our lifetime. But imagine if there was a possibility now that there were other opportunities to realise the No Child Left Behind, to realise the fact that every learner could reach their potential, to realise that learning is about knowledge production, not just knowledge consumption. And what we're going to put to you is that the new digital cyber world that is being slowly introduced into our education system has some affordances which as yet we haven't fully exploited, but if we did and considered them, they might allow for some different kind of assessments. And Bill will elaborate more on the assessment side, but I'll just go over seven of these affordances. And the first one, of course, is we don't have to be confined by the timetable and the periods. Learning now can be ubiquitous, anywhere, anytime. And anyone can access that experience in some cyberspace. Also, it is possible and much easier now to do differentiated learning. One teacher, 30 learners, one teacher, 50 learners, even with an aide, is very hard to address the needs of every particular learner and have them moving in different ways and with a different pace against our textbook or against our curriculum. The possibility of creating learning pathways for learners that they can progress towards comparable goals along different pathways that meet their needs is made much more possible in the context of a digital environment. And as part of this environment, which is the production of knowledge, where learners produce, they can reflect upon their production. Metacognition becomes a way of thinking about your thinking and sharing with others. Collaborative intelligence becomes important, much more important and much more available to learners and teachers in a world where learning is ubiquitous, it's differentiated, where peers are working together, where you can share the production of your knowledge with other learners, with other teachers, perhaps with other experts outside of your classroom. And of course, the possibility of creating rather than just consuming projects and knowledge is made available by the digital environment and its multimodality, whether we're filming a debate or recording a presentation or using images and text, the multimodality that is available, and it's a revolutionary dimension of the meaning making because it's about the making text, making an image, making audio is available to any learner through the digital form in which it is found in the cyber world. And finally, in the seven affordances, the possibility of formative assessment, that is assessing as you go, is made possible for every learner because as they produce in this space, as we've said earlier during this course, the production of the knowledge in the cyber world can be discovered, can be regarded as information and data, and can be decisions can be made about how to value what is produced, the process of producing, and the outcome of producing. Bill now will take these seven affordances, and he's going to expand on the assessment potential of each one of them.
So I'm going to talk about the assessment aspects of these seven affordances. I'm going to go through each one of them. So ubiquitous learning, whereas assessment had to happen at, you know, between 9 and 12 on Friday the 16th of April or whenever it was, and everybody in the room with the door closed and unable to talk to each other and with proctors and all that kind of stuff. Now what we can do is we can probably build assessments where we can assess what you're doing, whether you're in the room and whatever time you are. Recursive feedback. What we can do is we can also build feedback systems, assessment systems, which are not linear, but which are more recursive. So here's the linearity of a typical assessment system. I do my essay, I hand it in, I get a B+, which means I'm mediocre, and I get a few comments, and what do? I go into the next topic. Or I study for a year and I do the exam and I pass or I fail, and what do? Well, I either do it again or something. So it's linear, it's not recursive, whereas what we can have now in these digital environments is feedback systems where we're getting a lot of feedback from humans, machines, and every little moment of assessment is contributing to our learning. We can also assess multimodal things. So in other words, if we're building a project which includes videos, it includes data sets, it includes all these multimodal objects which are typical of the digital world, we can assess those as well, both machine assessments, but also rubric-based human assessments, peers, self-assessment, teacher assessment, and so on. We can also be assessing what we call active knowledge making, which is I'm doing a project, and there are multiple versions, I can see how much time you've put into it, because we can be constantly monitoring what's actually happening in that process. We can also monitor not just individual intelligence, but collaborative intelligence. The feedback I gave to my peers on their work, the way in which I took on board their feedback, the way in which I explicitly recognized the feedback they'd taken on, and we can measure all those things and value them. We can also make metacognition a much bigger part of the process. So I do my work while I'm looking at the rubric. I give someone peer feedback against that rubric, which is, you know, the work I'm doing here. On one side of my screen, perhaps, is something about the topic that I'm working on, French Revolution. But on the right, it's about causes and facts and evidence and all that kind of stuff. That's what we're talking about. So metacognition can be a big part of the process by building students in as self-assessors and peer assessors. And finally, differentiated learning. So, you know, you can be doing different projects on different things, same subject, same whatever, and we can be assessing those things. It doesn't have to be standardized. We can be looking at what's comparable in the project you've done with a project that somebody else has done against a rubric or in terms of the kind of work that you've created in a digital portfolio, for example. So they're all ways in which we can expand the frame of assessment in what Mary and I call e-learning ecologies. So on that basis, I want to mention now two things that I think that are game changers in this world. One is something that I call big data, which is collecting a whole lot of data about the learning process because kids are working in cloud-based computer-mediated environments. And the other thing is what we do with that data, which is a set of analytical processes that have been given the phrase learning analytics.